Sag ich immerhin. Amen. Tell us who you are and where you're from. Brother Robert, we'll start with you back here. Amen. That was a joy, Brother Matt. Amen. Glad to have Brother Matt and his wife Joy with us. Brother Bob. I tell you what, old Bob June, I've known Bob for I don't know how many years, but he stood faithful and unchanging. Amen. And I know he's got some years on him now, but he ain't a bit different than he was when I first met him. Yeah. I'm an old man, and you was old when I met you. Can you still stand on your head, Bob? Can you still stand on your head?
I haven't lived a year,
but. Amen. 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 Brother Dean. Brother Dean, we're glad to have you. Amen. Good to have all you preachers with us tonight. Good to have all the visitors with us tonight. Now I've enjoyed the singing. I'm ready for some preaching. How about you? Amen. Well, Brother Matt, this is not the first time Brother Matt has preached here. We didn't do it this year, but usually, for those of you that aren't members here, in February, we'll have local preachers come in on Wednesday night, and we'll call it our Wednesday night February revival. And in 2020, Brother Matt came, and he got to meet Brother Roger. And it wasn't very long before Brother Roger passed away, and I'm so glad that them two got to meet. And he done a great job that night, and Brother Matt is a wonderful man of God. Wonderful, wonderful job over his life. We just thank the Lord for knowing them who to bring in. I'm just an outsider. But from the outside, I don't think they could have done a better job than the man that God selected for them in Brother Matt Morrison. Brother Matt, you come on and preach. We're glad to have his wife Joy here with him tonight. And he's just going to mind the Lord and preach the Word of God to us. If you run out of RC, we brought you some water.
You got to watch what you say behind the pulpit. I said I liked RC, and everywhere I go now, I get RC. So in a pulpit, I can shake it up and have some fun with you. If I miss this one and get this one, then I'm going to bubble out my ears. I promise you. Well, I'm glad to be here tonight, and we've been praying for y'all, and I hope you've been praying for me, because all is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One come down. I want you to grab your Bibles tonight, and I'm going to preach to you the message that we preached yesterday morning at Gospel Light. It's fresh on my heart, and I prayed about it, thought about it, and this is the direction I want to go to help you all out here tonight. Turn in your Bibles to Habakkuk, please. Habakkuk, that minor prophet. There's nothing minor about Habakkuk, I promise you that. They're just called minor prophets because of the smallness of the book, of the letter. Only three little chapters in Habakkuk, but I'll promise you that by the time we get done tonight, you'll say, my, what a book of the Bible it is. Habakkuk, it's about four books to the left from Matthew. So if you'll find Matthew, take a left. You'll find Habakkuk. If you're like me, you have a hard time finding books like that. Somebody said, where's Habakkuk at? I said, right beside Nahum. Where in the world is Nahum at? You know? But anyway, find Habakkuk. I want to talk to you tonight by way of an encouragement. I've been thinking about how in the world do we start off a revival meeting. I think one of the ways to do that is just to remind you of the goodness of God. Refocus our minds. We're living in crazy times, amen? Seems like things are unraveling. That's okay because the church stands strong. It is the pillar and ground of truth. But we're built upon the rock, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, one thing about it, when the world looks at us as believers, they ought to see people who are not shaken in mind. They should see people that's not full of fear. I understand we've had to say goodbye to loved ones recently, and we've had some rough times going. But God has not given us a spirit of fear. And the church should never, ever be characterized by being fearful. Anytime fear comes into your heart, mark it down, that's not of God. That's just not Him doing that. That's the enemy doing that. That's your emotions doing that. And remember, the very first emotion that ever came to man after the fall of sin was fear. Fear. So open your Bibles if you haven't yet. Habakkuk chapter 3. We're going to start from the back and go forward. I want to talk to you tonight on this idea. Don't let anything steal your song. Don't let nothing steal your song. No person, no thing, No government, no mandate. Don't let anything steal your joy that you had placed in your heart the day you were born again. If you're like me, you need to stoke that thing up. Once in a while, you need to have a retuning done. And God does that. He'll retune your heart and mind when we need that. And boy, we find the prophet Habakkuk. He needs a tune-up job. He lost his song. And you'll see that he regains it by the end of the book. We're going to begin in Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17. Read along, please, silently as I read it audibly. Would you stand for the reading of the Word of God tonight, please? Although the fig tree shall not blossom, and neither shall the fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flocks shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. That's pretty bleak. Does it remind you just a little bit of the spirit of America? Spirit of churches today. But go on and read verse 18, please. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. Friend, there are a lot of things that can be taken away from you, but one thing that can't be taken away from you, and that's your salvation. You can always joy in your salvation. Well, let's pray tonight. We're going to be talking about not letting anything take your song. If you've let your song get a little bit down, if you've let your song come out of tune, listen tonight, would you please? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we pause and we ask that you would take that heavenly tuning fork and that you would strike it against our heart tonight. And Lord, whatever reverberation that might come off of it, you tune our hearts according to your will. Father, we're all discouraged from time to time, distraught. Lord, we're sometimes wondering what is going to come. We know that you know, and that's enough for us. Help us to know in times like this to just trust and obey. Father, tonight in the Word, would you please engraft it into the heart of the listening ear. Help this church tonight with this weak preacher. Speak now for thy servant heareth. Your lovely name we pray, dear Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for standing for the Word of God. You may be seated. Today I want to talk to you tonight about somebody who just might be here who's overly distraught about the situations that we've been laboring in the last couple of years. Trotting through those, and listen, I've been talking to pastors from all over the country. Just last week I was with a couple from California, and you think we got a bad North Carolina? We don't have anything compared to what they're facing in California, I'll promise you that. I was talking to pastors that literally had to bust their folks in secretly from another location, bring them into the church in a clandestine way, and then they would gather with shades drawn just to worship the Lord in America. You would think that that would be Red China, wouldn't you, with an underground church, but that's here in America. Another pastor said, we have helicopters that will literally go above our churches. We have people that will come in our services and literally be filming us. We've got it pretty good in North Carolina. We need to thank God for that. I'd like to see things a lot more on the right in North Carolina, but I'm thankful for what we do have. And listen, I'm just saying, you might be here tonight and you might be one of those folks that you're kind of in the molly grub and you're down and out, and it's easy to get that way if you don't pay attention to the right source. Be very careful of always going to the news syndicate source to get the update of what the day's happening. Can I tell you, you hold in your lap, and I'm holding in my hand something that is always fresh and relevant, up to date with what's going on in the world. You're going to find out that Habakkuk tonight is a book that seems like it was written just yesterday because it's right in tune with the time in which we live. Well, make sure that you got your nose in the book of the Bible. It doesn't have to always be a political problem, though. I'm talking now on national issues, but maybe you're here tonight and you've got personal issues. You've got marital problems. Maybe you have a son or a daughter that's giving you grief and sorrow, stealing your sleep at night. Maybe you have health issues. Maybe you have emotional issues. I don't know what your problem is tonight, but I'll promise you this. You can have a song no matter what you face. There's a song in your heart that the sweet Holy Ghost will play in your heart if you just allow Him to do that. And I want Him to do it. I need it. I don't know about you, but I need that sweet Spirit of God to just come along and blow that heavenly breeze across my heart. And that's what we're hungry for tonight, isn't it? Well, the book of Habakkuk was written in a time of national calamity. It was a time of national despair. Everything seemed to be unraveling like it is in America today. As a matter of fact, a lot of people are saying that this time is going to be known as the age of the unraveling, meaning society as we've known it, marriage as we've known it, the churches as we've known it, society as we've known it and enjoyed it to this time, it's coming apart at the seams. Well, don't let the church come apart. Don't let your family come apart. Don't let your faith come apart. you don't have to follow in the suit of the current of the tide in the world. Any old dead fish can float down the river, but it takes somebody with a backbone and muscle to go against the stream. And that's what the world needs today. It's the pockets of churches like this one right here tonight that's holding this thing together. It's the Holy Ghost in churches like this one right here tonight that's holding an America in place. It's not the rivets of politics. It's not the nails of finances. It's not Wall Street or anything like that. It's the people that are praying on their knees holding this thing together. I'm looking at the people that's holding America together. Habakkuk was that kind of man. Habakkuk was a man who was intensely patriotic. Loved his land, loved Israel. He loved his people. He loved his preacher. That's just the kind of man that he was. He wanted things to be done right. He wanted Israel to come out of that tailspin. He wanted them to get back and know revival and to know the presence of God again. The problem was it didn't happen. He was a man that was praying, fasting, seeking, asking, and it just wasn't happening. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? We love our nation. And we're red-blooded through and through. And I'm glad to see the American flag right there facing right back at me. I love this land. But I'm going to tell you something, Christian. We need to fall in love with God a whole lot more than the land. And if you're here tonight and you say, I'm a patriot, and you put that above being a Christian, you're in trouble. Because America's on its way down. But can I tell you, you can anchor your soul in the rock of ages that isn't going to go down when the flood comes up. I promise you that. So make sure that your first place is in your faith. And then your patriotic attitude can come below that. Habakkuk had it a little bit backwards here, and you'll see here that he faced some questions that we're faced with today. This is what he was saying in the book of Habakkuk. God, where are you at? God, why don't you come on scene? God, you said you'd be faithful to the prayers of your people. Where are you at? Why aren't you moving? That was the attitude of Habakkuk. Did you know that there are people today that are walking away from the church, have been for the last 2 years, because they cannot reconcile in their mind how God would allow America to get to the place where it's at? God, why would you allow our churches to be shut down for a while? And why would you allow this to disrupt the ministry of the churches? And some of the weaker brethren and sisters of Christ have fallen away. They've walked away from their faith because of a hardship that's come into the issue. And they ponder, how in the world can we be having the problems that we're having? How, God, can you have the problems in my life and in my family and you still be God? Now, that sounds easy enough from this side of good to be able to look at somebody that's struggling with that and say, you ought not do that. But when you're in a fire, and when it's your son or daughter, or when it's your spouse, or when it's your church, it's a whole different ball of wax. Habakkuk, he's right in the middle of the battle, and he cannot figure out why God is not showing up. Maybe you recently have said something along these lines. God, where are you at in all of this? Well, you're not alone. I'll promise you that. You're not alone if you've asked that question. Now, I want you to look to chapter 1 of Habakkuk, please. As you read the book, you're going to find out very quickly that Habakkuk was frustrated with the same question. And if you're frustrated with that question of why God and where God and when God, you're going to find this tiny little book to be a great comfort to you, I promise. Look at chapter 1, please. In chapter 1, we find out that there's a perplexing problem for Habakkuk. It perplexes him. It knocks him off of his foundation. He begins to question things that he should not question. And it starts out, if you look in chapter 1, verse 1, as a burden. The burden which Habakkuk, the prophet, did see. So the whole entire book opens up with a man of God who is so burdened for his people, so hungry for the move of God, he's not seen it, and he says, I have a burden. Now that's how the book opens up. Now look to chapter 2. In chapter 2, you'll find out that perplexing problem that he had, all of a sudden he gets a right perspective. He gets the proper perspective on chapter 1, and in chapter 2, things begin to happen. God sits him down and he says, son, we're going to go through a Sunday school lesson together, just me and you. And he tunes up Habakkuk's heart. And I want you to see in chapter 2, verse 3, the burden turns into the vision of God. For the vision here, let's look at it in verse 2. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon the tables that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but an end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it. Because it will surely come and it will not tarry. This is what you have in chapter 1, an overwrought prophet that says, oh God, why aren't you moving on Israel? Chapter 2, God comes down to the prophet and says, sit down, we're going to have a talk. and the vision of God comes. We would say today that the vision of God is the Word of God, the preaching of God's Word. Vision in the Old Testament time was the direct revelation from God to the man of God, and he would speak the Word of God. So it's the Word of God that has come, changed the burden now to a right perspective. And then look over in chapter 3 on how chapter 3 begins. It goes from a burden to a vision and now to a prayer, to a praise and to a prayer. Look with me in chapter 3, verse 1. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet upon Shigionoth. Now here's the issue. Chapter 1, there was the need of a man or a woman who could pray. The problem was his heart was not right. He lost his song. He lost his perspective on things. He was looking at the storm around him, and he could not pray. He had not the faith or the desire to pray. But boy, how God changes his mind. So let's start off, first of all, by looking at the problem of chapter 1. Flip back to chapter 1, and let's read verses 1 and 2. This is the perplexing problem that Habakkuk has, that you and I will have today in America. The burden which Habakkuk, the prophet, did see, O Lord, how long shall I cry, and thou wilt not hear, even cry out unto thee of violence, and thou wilt not save. Can you see the bitterness of the man of God right there? You sure can. There was a problem here that he had, and the problem was heaven is being silent. Heaven's silent unto my cry, and that perplexed the old prophet. He says, God, I've been praying, and I've been praying, and I've been fasting, and I've been faithful. Why is heaven silent unto me? Now, if you've never been there in your faith, you will be. There are times that we just don't understand, and in like chapter 2, God comes on scene and says, you need to wait. You don't understand. You just need to wait. Have faith, continue on, and wait on me. Now, I want you to see in your King James Bible the word cry there in verse 2. How long shall I cry? Now, it's not just a sob and boo-hoo. It's not somebody getting a Kleenex. This word cry in the Hebrew language is two different words. It's a compound word. In our English Bible, it's just C-R-Y, cry. But in the original, there's two words that make that up. And the one just simply means this. It just simply means to make a petition, to make a request. The other one means to shout. So when you put those together, you get the idea of where Habakkuk is. He's saying, God, where are you? He's crying out that request to him. Now, have you ever shouted out toward the Lord? I'm not saying shout at him. I'm saying, have you ever shouted toward the Lord? Have? I have. Lord, I don't understand this. God, how long? Lord, why aren't you moving? Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? What am I saying? I'm saying don't be too hard on the prophet Habakkuk. At least he had the desire to be upset at what he saw. And it moved his heart to begin to plead and to cry out for his nation. The greatest danger of the church today is to accept the abnormal as normal. The greatest danger of your congregation tonight is to say, well, this is the way it's going to be. We're just going to have to accept things. Let's pack up tent and let's just call it done because we're not going to see the move of God. That's the most deadly thing that can happen in the church today. At least Habakkuk had an attitude that says we got to cry out to God. Is that where we live or not? That's exactly where we're living at today. This perplexed him. And I want you to look with me in verse 3. Of chapter 1, he said, why dost thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance? For spoiling and violence are before me, and there are they that rise up in strife and contention. Sounds like modern day contemporary of America. Verse 4, therefore the law is slacked, and judgment doth never go forth, for the wicked doth compass about the righteous, and therefore wrong judgment proceedeth. Hello? It seems like wrong is being lifted up and right is being put down in America today. And that's what was bothering Habakkuk right here in this passage of Scripture. Now, there was another prophet that was prophesying the same time old Habakkuk was. His name was Jeremiah. Jeremiah was that prophet of the southern kingdom. And these old boys come on scene just before they get carried away by the Babylonians to go into 70 years captivity. They have the difficulty of prophesying to a stiff-necked nation that says, God's going to judge your sin. We're going to get carried away. Everybody else, all the other Joel Osteens, excuse me, were saying, oh, no, God's going to come and he's going to deliver us. He's going to lift us up. Oh, God's in favor with us. He loves us. Jeremiah and Habakkuk were saying, that ain't it at all. The prophecy of the word of the Lord says you're going into captivity and God is going to judge you because of your sin. Now, could you imagine being in those men's shoes to a nation that was rejecting them? They're heartbroken over their nation to begin with. But I want you to listen to the words of Jeremiah chapter 5, verse 30. He said, a wonderful, and I don't mean good. That means something that strikes awe and wonder in you. A wonderful and horrible thing is committed in the land. Verse 31, the prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests bear rule by their names, and my people love to have it so. I don't know if you caught all of that or not, but basically this is what was going on. The sin had become so permeable within the nation of Israel that it crept into the temple, it crept into the priesthood, it crept into the Levites. And Jeremiah is looking around and he says, my priests are not proclaiming the word of the Lord. And the Levites, they're serving out of their own will. They're not even following the Levitical command. They're doing what they want to do. And what's worse, the people like it. They enjoy it that way. And this is what Jeremiah was weeping over. And this is what Habakkuk was preaching against. The things that had crept into the people of God so distraught them. Can I tell you, our greatest need in America today is for churches to get thoroughly right with God. It's the churches. Our hope's not in Capitol Hill. Our hope's not in the White House. Our hope's not in Raleigh. Our hope is right here in the altar of the church of the living God. And it's God's people that is the only hope for America. It's only God's people. The only hope that America has is the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we take it out and lives are changed, that is the only hope that America has today. Friend, thank God for the pastor that you have here at this church that will rear back, open the Bible up, and let her fly. Regardless how it lands, he's pleasing the Lord and not trying to please a man. You need to thank God for that man, because I get the calls all the time. Do you have a preacher? We need a preacher all over the land. Do you have a preacher? Do you know of a preacher? Pulpits are barren today of good men of God preaching the word of God. You need to love him, back him up, and his wife. Back him up, because there's too many preachers today that are user-friendly toward their evangelistic efforts. They're seeker-sensitive and don't dare say anything that would offend anyone. And I'm not out to hurt anybody, but I'm not going to water it down, boys. And your pastor's not going to water it down either. Now, it's bad enough when sin is abounding around the world, but it's much worse when it is laid down to in the church. Even comes through the church doors. God help us. Now, I want you to look at verse 4 one more time. Because the priesthood, in Jeremiah's account of the same time of Habakkuk, said the priesthood has gone to pot. Look with me. Therefore, in verse 4, the law is slack. Now you say, what is the law? Well, we're holding it. We're holding it. It's the word of God. The law is slacked. Now that word slacked means this. It's paralyzed. It does not have the ability to move and to change and to correct like it should. Why? Because the hands that were supposed to be sending it forth weren't. Because the church is in dismay, power of God's word is paralyzed. Does it sound like America today? He says, listen, I'm troubled, heaven's silence, and I'm looking around and I'm seeing earth sin. He said, but really what beats all, he says, it seems like hell is succeeding. It seems like hell's getting ahead of us here. Look with me in verse 5 and 6. He said, behold ye among the heathen and regard and wonder marvelously, for I will work a work in your days which ye shall not believe, though it be told you. God says, lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that's the Babylonians, that bitter and hasty nation which shall march through the breadth of the land and possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. Now, I want you to understand, this is God coming on scene, verse 5 and 6, to reply to old Habakkuk. But in Habakkuk's mind, he's looking around and saying, heaven's not winning, hell's winning. And I hear so many Christians today that have that same mindset. Heaven's not winning, we're going backwards, we're in retreat. What's going on? Friend, we're not losing the battle. Understand, everything in God's timeline is going right according to schedule. Things aren't falling apart, they're falling into place. understand that. We're just in that Laodicean age that Jesus Christ told us we would be in before the rapture of the church. But I want you to see that when God responds to old Habakkuk here, he doesn't even give an explanation to old Habakkuk. He doesn't say, well, Habakkuk, here's why. He says, I'm going to do something that's going to make your ears ring. Now, when God speaks like that to His church and to His people, we think that it's mysterious and strange, and it is, because His thoughts are so far above our thoughts. Now, that's just God coming back to them, and He's coming and talking to them and saying, Habakkuk, I'm going to do something here, and you think it's bad now? You wait a little while, because it's going to get a lot worse than what it is now. I'm going to raise up a nation against my people, and I want you to know I'm sending them. I'm the one that's sending the judgment upon the land. I'm going to tell you something, folks. When you boil all the sap down to the syrup, there's a sovereign God in control of this nation. And we have been murdering babies a long time. And we've been doing all kinds of things that displease the Lord for a long time. We are getting our just desert. God's bringing judgment on this land, folks. You can mark that down. You say, what is He doing? He's allowing us to have what we want, a land without Him. So He gives to that nation that wants nothing to do with Him exactly what they want. Fine, I'll withdraw. And you see the consequence of that. Verses 12 and 13, would you look down in chapter 1? And old Habakkuk now responds back to God. And he says, art thou not from everlasting, O Lord my God, mine Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment. And O mighty God, that thou hast established them for correction. Listen to verse 13. Thou art purer of purer eyes than to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity. Wherefore lookest thou upon them that deal treacherously, and holdest thy tongue when the wicked devoureth the man that is more righteous than he? You know what old Habakkuk is doing? He's having a hard time with what God told him He was going to do. He says, wait a minute, Lord. I've been praying for revival. I've been praying for renewal. And you're telling me you're going to send a heathen, pagan, idolatrous people in to ransack Israel? God said, that's exactly what I'm going to do, because your people aren't listening to me. And so Habakkuk says, no, wait a minute, Lord. There's got to be something wrong here. You won't let this happen to us, because after all, Mount Zion is the place that has your temple on it. Lord, you won't do that. We're your chosen people. We're your favorite people. We're the seed of Abraham. You wouldn't allow that to happen to us. And people in America today, if you're not careful, you'll slip into the same mindset. Oh, that won't happen to America. God won't do that to America. Surely not. We send more missionaries to the world than any other nation. We are the Christian nation. We're the second Israel. We are supernaturally and divinely established, and we've been supernaturally sustained all these years. You're right. But that don't matter to a holy God when His people are in sin. So all of a sudden, old Habakkuk says, well, Lord, I think you're blessing the wrong people, and I think you're judging the wrong people. I think you got it backwards. Now, folks, can you identify with chapter 1? I can. I can identify with old Habakkuk how he feels. Perplexed, troubled. What in the world is going on? Well, second of all, he gets the right perspective. And now we look into chapter 2. Would you look with me in verse 1? I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and watch to see what He will say unto me and what I will answer when I am reproved. Now he's getting somewhere. He's getting to the place of humility before God. And he shut his mouth. He's opened his heart. And he says, Lord, I don't know things that I thought I once knew. And Lord, I'm ready to listen. And there's the place where revival can begin, right there. Churches can be so upset and in turmoil, in a whirlwind with everything that's going on. We can be fighting the president, the governor, and everybody in between. And the power of God be 10 miles from you. It's when we sit down and get quiet. We say, Lord, we're in a mess. And we're in a mess because we chose to take you out of our schools. We're in a mess because we chose to take you out of the court system. We're in a mess because we've taken you sometimes out of the church. It's when we get quiet before God right here. Habakkuk had been doing too much talking. Sometimes we come in, we demand an audience, we say, Our Father, and we kick open the doors of heaven, and we say, Lord, it's your servant, hear me, instead of saying, Lord, I'm your servant, I hear you. That's what was happening to Habakkuk. He was just into the place where he said, Lord, I'm ready to listen. Do you have a quiet place with the Lord? You have a closet with the Lord where you can get alone with God just by yourself? And there you get with Him, and sometimes you'll talk to Him, and other times, whew, He moves in and He talks to you. And when you leave that prayer room, Brother Brian, you are a different man. You walk in like Habakkuk in chapter 1. Oh, boy, I don't know. You get into quiet time with God. God's presence comes in. You get quiet. You worship Him in the beauty of His holiness. You walk out a different man. God can do more in your life and correct more in your life and in your family and in your church in just 5 minutes of His presence than a year of all kinds of other counsel. You get alone with Him and He does things and you don't know how. His presence just comes and that balm comes and is applied. I can't explain it, but you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. Well, let me give you four things here to ensure that you got the right view of things going on around you. I'll be quick. Number one, as Christians today, we're looking around us. Churches seem to be falling apart, some shutting down, pastors leaving, all kinds of problems, America dissolving. Number one, to get the right perspective in what's going on, would you please remember the reliability of the Bible? Remember the reliability of the Bible. I'm going to say this very carefully. There was a gentleman that came into my office last Friday, and I could tell by the phone call that I took from him the day before, he was very distraught. Very distraught. He came in and he sat down, and this was a young man, and he was a student of the Bible. He was a good, serious Christian. He is a good, serious Christian. And he said, Pastor, I'm afraid that we have our eschatology wrong maybe here at Gospel Light. And I said, I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to persuade me. He said, I'm not talking about that. He said, let me explain. Long story short, the COVID vaccine, and I'm not even going to lift hands on that. We'll split the church. But he thought that he had got it. He was sure that it was the mark of the beast. I said, brother, that cannot be the mark of the beast. Chronologically speaking, the beast isn't even here to give the mark. I said, there's something very big that's got to happen first, sir. That's the rapture of the church. I said, don't listen to these fellows on television that try to take one verse out of text and build a whole theory around it. Turn off the television. Get into the Bible. Get into the Bible. You're so distraught over something that's not even scriptural or biblical. And what I'm talking about is in troubled times like we're in right now, get into the book. It was the vision from heaven that came to Habakkuk that straightened him out. What is it going to be that straightens my troubled heart? Straightens out the fears in me, the uncertainties in me. It's the Word of God. It's quick and it's powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And it has the power to settle your mind, to settle your heart down. Listen, I want you to see what it says in chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. And the Lord answered me, thank God that He did, write the vision, make it plain upon the tables that he may run that readeth. And the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Amen. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. And that's a good indication of what we ought to be doing right now. There are some people that are so wound up because of what they're reading on internet and what they're getting on their iPhone and what they're getting on the newspaper and watching on the Fox News, and they're getting all twisted around and their emotions are getting all stirred up and they're being distracted. And the devil's going like this. Stay focused on Christ. Keep your family in this church. Back up the pastor. Stay in the Bible, and you're going to be all right. You'll be all right. I promise you that. Remember the reliability of the Bible. Number two, focus on the resources that you have as a saint. Look with me in chapter 2, verse 4. Behold, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. Mentioned at least three times in that King James Bible. The just shall live by faith. What is the resource that the child of God has today? Friend, it's faith. It's faith. And the thing that you and I have to do in these troubled times, and they're going to get hotter, we've just got to put faith in God's facts. Just trust Him. It's going to get down to this just simple, plain, country boy faith. I'm just going to trust God, come what may. I'm just settled. I'm resolved. I'm just assured in the Word of God. I don't care, come what may, whatever somebody says, I'm just going to exercise faith in the Word of God. I mean, that's really where we got to get back to. We've got to get back to that kind of just raw faith, so to speak. I want to go on to verse 3 for sake of time. Focus on the retribution of the sinner. when you look around at what's going on Capitol Hill and the craziness that's happening within our governmental systems today, it's enough to make you want to bite nails in two. And you think, where in the world is justice in America today? I'm going to tell you something. There's a God in heaven that knows everything that's going on, and He's going to take everything into account. Look with me in verse 5 and 6. Yea, also because he transgresseth by wine, and a proud man neither keepeth at home. That's a fellow that goes out on his wife, or enlargeth his desire as hell, and is as death, and cannot be satisfied. But he gathereth unto him all the nations, and heapeth up unto him all the people. Shall not all these take up a parable against him as a taunting proverb against him, and say, woe to him that increaseth that which is not his? How long? And to him that ladeth himself with thick clay. You know, that thick clay, I often think about the old saying. You ever heard somebody say, boy, he's laying it on thick? He's putting it on real thick. That's the way the Bible describes the people of Israel at this time that were so wicked in their heart. It was like they were daubing themselves, not with a little bit of a smear here and a little bit of smear. They were putting that on thick. And the thickness was talking about their aggressiveness to sin. And old Habakkuk had a problem with it. I don't know about you all, but I get tired of seeing the rainbow flag. I get tired of seeing that thing flown at the U.S. embassies in foreign nations. I get tired of seeing that stuff all the time. And you think, where in the world is the righteousness of America? Where in the world is the judgment of that which is right? And why in the world is it being lauded as being something good? I just want you to see, God is saying, listen, I've not gone soft on sin, son. Habakkuk, I have not gone soft on sin. And as a matter of fact, in chapter 2, you'll find that word woe mentioned 5 times. We read it once. Woe means that God is pronouncing judgment. Woe upon that person. 5 times right there in that chapter, God is going to pronounce woe to that individual. Listen, God's not gone soft on sin. God's not gotten soft in his old age, friend. Mark it down, the God of the Old Testament that has seemed to be so just and quick to give judgment. That's the same God of the New Testament. The only difference is there's a bloodstained cross between the two that stands for me and you, and which God gave all of the judgment for our sins upon. But that same God of justice and judgment, that's the same God we serve tonight. God's not blinking his eye at America's sin. You mark it down, folks. These fellas that's getting away with things and ladies getting away with things, God's mill grinds slowly but surely. Mark it down. Number 4, keeping the might right kind of a perspective is focus on the reign of the saints, our future. Realize that this is just temporary. Just a fleeting piece of steam, as James said. That's all this is. Don't drive your pegs down too deep in the earth. We're not going to be here long, folks. If you get all wrapped up in what's going on in America and it wraps you up so much that you lose vision of your heavenly home, something wrong. There's something wrong there. The peace of God is to rule your heart, Peter said. Rule your heart. Now, I want you to focus on the reign of the saints that's soon to come. Look with me in chapter 2, verse 14. For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Do you believe that tonight? Now, I know that hadn't happened yet. That's talking about the millennial reign, but it's going to happen. King Jesus is going to come back. He's going to set things right. He's going to sit on the throne of David over in Israel, and every knee is going to bow down to our King. It's going to happen. Well, I not only believe that, but I want you to go with me in verse 20 of chapter 2. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Oh, I like that. Habakkuk says, Lord, where are you? And old Jehovah God, Habakkuk, I'm right up here. I am in my heavenly temple, and there's no emergency meetings up here. There's no panic up here. I'm not wringing my hands. We're not worried about one thing that's going on. All is going according to plan. Thank you very much. You just need to remember that God is in control of this thing. He's going to bring this thing to pass. Now, we're going to finish by looking at chapter 3 very, very quickly. Now, he had a problem in chapter 1. In chapter 2, he got the right perspective on things because the word of the Lord himself set him straight. And oh my, how chapter 3 changes. Chapter 3, we have the prayer and the praise of it all. I want you to understand that now God is going to come and tell him what he needs to do. What in the world is the Christian supposed to do in these troubled times in which we live? The church has never experienced anything quite like what we are tonight. These are uncharted waters. So what would the Bible tell us to do? 2 things listed in chapter 3. I want you to begin reading verse 1. A prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet, upon Shigionoth. That's an instrument. So he's literally getting ready to sing a song to us. Oh Lord, I have heard thy speech and was afraid. Oh Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make it known. And in wrath, remember mercy. That's the prayer of the church tonight. Oh Lord, in your judgment, remember mercy, please. But Lord, we know that revival's coming. If it doesn't come right now, we know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is going to come, and this old earth that's groaning in travail is going to be rescued from the sin curse it's under. We know it's coming. But he goes on to say in verse 3, God came from Teman and the Holy One from Mount Paran. Both of those mounts are very, very close to Mount Sinai. It's talking about when God came down and met his people, Selah. Now, where in the world do you find that word Selah at? You find it in the Psalms. What are the Psalms? Songs. This old boy singing. He's singing and he's starting to sing and he says, revival is coming, revival is coming. And oh Lord, as you came down upon the people there on Mount Sinai and there was great fire in the mountain. Do it again, oh Lord. Let's pause and think about that. So there's some instruments played, and then he picks it right back up here in verse 4. And the Bible says, well, let's pick it up in verse 3 halfway. And his glory covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise, and his brightness was as the light. And he had horns coming out of his hands, talking about power. And there was the hiding of his power. Before him there went a pestilence, burning coals went forth at his feet. He stood and he measured the earth. He beheld and he drove asunder the nations, and the everlasting mountains were scattered. The perpetual hills did bow before him, and his ways are everlasting. Now, wait a minute. Is this the same prophet in chapter 1 that said, God, where are you at? Why have you forsaken us? Why are you quiet to us? Why are you allowing the unjust man rule? What happened? Chapter 2 happened. He had a meeting with God. He got his heart right. All of a sudden, what happens? His song came back. He says, wait a minute, I'm seeing things from a different point of view now. And the first thing that we see in verses 1 through 6, in the troubled times, Habakkuk would tell us, remember the greatness of God. In verse 6, it's talking about the mountains bowing before Jehovah God. It's talking about the hills trembling at the presence of God, like when he came down upon Mount Sinai. Did you know if you would look at Mount Sinai to this day, it is charred black halfway down where God came down on it? Sure is. And old Habakkuk is saying, oh God, I'm going to remember your greatness. All nations are but a drop in a bucket compared to thee. And then he goes on here, and I want you to see the second thing that he says, verse 17 and 18. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, and neither shall the fruit be in the vines, and the labor of the olive shall fail, and all the fields shall yield no meat, and the flocks shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herds in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. He says, remember the greatness of God in the beginning of his song. In the latter part of his song, he's saying, and rejoice in the goodness of God. I like that sis that was sitting right about here singing, and when she would sing, she'd lift her hand up. She was giving testimony that what she was singing is true, and the Spirit of God was bearing witness. I like that. That's what's happening to Habakkuk. He's saying, God has shown me this. I got a change of heart. The Spirit of God is upon me. And he couldn't help but sing. He rejoiced in the Lord. Man, you want to know something that will get the world to scratch their head? What's going on is when Christians in the church, number one, remember the greatness of God. Don't back down. Stand their ground. Draw the line in the sand. And while they're doing it, give praise to the Lord. What's going on there? Well, it's the Lord. It's the Lord. Now, what are you and I to do? Remember God's greatness. Rejoice in His goodness in this time. It don't matter if gasoline gets up to $4 a gallon. God owns the cattle on a thousand hills, the wealth in every mine. What does it matter if gas gets up to $4? What does it matter if the stock market closes? I've never seen the righteous forsaken or begging for bread. What is that? Those are songs in your heart that when the hard time comes, you can recall to memory and say, God is faithful. He's not going to lie. He's promised you food, raiment, and clothing. And I just have enough dumbness about me, so to speak, to believe him. I believe him. He's going to take us through this thing, church. Just hang in there. But how? How? How do you do that, Brother Matt? Look at verse 19. The Lord God is my strength And he will make my feet like hinds' feet. That's the wild goats that can jump. And he will make me to walk upon mine high places to the chief singer on my stringed instruments. Oh, I like that. That's good. Now, I want you to contrast what he said here in the end of verse 19 with how he started in chapter 1. Chapter 1, he said, oh, me, Eeyore, the Baptist Eeyore. Oh, me, look at the back of the board. I don't know where the people... God met with that person, revived their heart. And at the end of that in chapter 3, he is singing the praise of Jehovah God. Now, let me ask you a question. Did anything happen around him? Did anything change in Israel? Did God change his mind with Babylonians? No. What did change? His heart. What has to happen in the churches of America today? Hearts need to be changed. We got to get alone and get quiet with God like he did. Now listen, you can choose to live in chapter 1. You can choose to live in chapter 3. I'm going to take chapter 3. By the grace of God. Let's pray tonight. Father, thank you for this church. Thank you for what it stands on. Thank you for its dear pastor and these good people. And Lord, as we go into the time of altar, I pray that you'd challenge us tonight. I pray that you would come. And Lord, for that person that's dealing with a very great difficulty in their life, I pray that they would just take your word face value, that they would come in simple faith and a pleasing faith unto thee and just give it to you, give it to you. So Father, please bless in this time. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Maybe the perplexing problem that you got is not nationally, not a national problem. Maybe it's something closer to where you live. Maybe it's America.